There's nothing like Minnesota high school football. Football nights are special. It's about the players, the fans.
Let's go!
The communities. Prep Preview is here to set the stage each week. Dig into the key rivalries, the unique stories, the players to watch, and break down what it all means. The Care TV Prep Preview on YouTube starts now.
Thanks for tuning in. Welcome to Prep Preview. It is November, and this week is section final week in Minnesota high school football. The winners this week go to the state playoffs. The losers are out. This is Prep Preview on YouTube. I'm Randy Shaver along with Craig Norkus, and we are covering high school football in Minnesota for games played on November 3rd, Friday night. Big week, lots of great matchups across the board.
There is. This is a little bit sad. It's the kind of the, not kind of, the penultimate show for the year. And so yeah, we've only got one left after this. So I want to be happimonious with you during this show.
Okay.
Meaning we're both going to be happy and harmonious. Okay. And don't go telling me that happimonious is not a word. First of all, I don't make up words. And just for reference, I brought the dictionary today. If we need to look up any words that you question during this show,
we're not playing Scrabble.
We have
so
the
I think
dictionary. Happimonious is a word. Would you like to slap me with this dictionary?
Oh, I would love to do that, but not right now.
You know what? If you slap me with this dictionary, would that be physical or verbal assault?
Probably both.
Okay.
Which actually would make me feel good either way.
Well, we're off to a rolling start with the happimonious theme. I'm happy. Okay. You're harmonious.
Well, it's the day after Halloween. I know, but you have something
yes,
you want to say.
Yes, the day after Halloween. I saw some really good football-themed costumes for Halloween this year. And I wanted to take a moment to share my two favorites.
Okay.
The first, this is Johnny. This is my nephew, Johnny. He's almost 12. He's got the ref costume. He's rolling with the ref costume.
Sure.
However,
yeah,
my sister, Kristen, Johnny's mom, said there was one problem with this outfit.
He's missing glasses.
No. He abused his authority as a ref and called no less than 68 personal foul penalties. Hmm. Overuse of power, the penalty prognosticating power of the flags. There were personal fouls called for using a spoon and no fork, a cutoff of eating the Halloween candy. There was a personal foul called for getting sent to bed. So with the abuse of the flag throwing, I'm guessing that maybe Johnny will not be a ref next year.
Probably
not. But I just
not.
Wanted to point out that you look great in that costume. Good job, Johnny. Okay, so the next best football themed costume I saw, check this out.
Oh my gosh.
Take a look at this. This comes courtesy of Sylvia and Andrew Fuentes. Is that not the best Aaron Rodgers costume that you've ever seen?
Oh my gosh.
Like, that looks more like Aaron Rodgers than Aaron Rodgers himself. But you know the best thing about this costume?
Yeah.
He actually had cards that he was autographing and giving them out as part of the, watch this.
No, he did not.
He's gonna have a card. He signed it for people. Here's your autograph card. I'm Aaron Rodgers.
Oh, for Pete's sake.
Two great costumes for Halloween this year, the football themed costumes I can never get enough of.
Well, good. I'm glad you got that out of your system. What did you dress up as?
Tape face, Orange Glove
Guy,
right. Remember?
Yes.
And we got no Halloween trick-or-treaters because of that, so they did take the warning.
Yes, they did. Probably a good thing, too. All right, we're down to the top 16 teams in each class, and for 6A, that means half the field is gone. Honestly, every game at this stage is a spotlight game, but we choose one to focus on, and that game this week is a rematch. Mankato West at Chanhassen. Number 2 in the state against number 1 in Class 5A. It's our spotlight game, part 2.
Number 2.
I think it'll be a really hard-fought football game in the fourth quarter, just like the last two we've played.
Our guys are ready. Our guys are excited. I mean, sometimes a loss is great. We've been playing awesome since then, you know? So that was one of the benefits.
Mankato West's only loss of the season was to Chan. on that stormy night in late September when many games across the state were delayed or postponed. Chanhassen won 21-14 after a 90-minute delay.
We found a way to make one more play. It was a really tight, contested game.
Well, we're not going to make excuses. We lost. We should have played better. We didn't do that. We didn't execute when we needed to. Even after that delay, we still honestly had the opportunities. We had the ball first and goal twice inside, once at the 4 and once at the 6. Hats off to Chan. They held us. We didn't get any points. And that's the difference maker right there.
Let's go. Have a night.
Both coaches expect a great Section 2 5A final in a great high school football atmosphere at Chanhassen. It's a shame only the winner advances to state because both deserve it.
There's one team on Friday that's gonna turn in their pads on Monday that's going to be better than at least five of the teams that are gonna make the state tournament. The biggest thing, honestly, that I'm telling my guys is that we learned is that we can't kill ourselves. I mean, we're a good football team. We can't make mistakes. I mean, we felt like in that game that we were right with them. We felt like at times we outplayed them, but we felt like we didn't make the big plays.
I hope our kids are excited. I hope they enjoy it. I think it'll be a great atmosphere Friday night. Minnesota football playoff weather, just like we would expect. Maybe a little snow flurries, hopefully no rain. Doesn't sound like any lightning, so that's a definite plus.
I am with you on that weather report. Let's hope that it stays the way it's forecasted right now, which is about 50 degrees.
That's perfect.
And clear skies on Friday night, November 3rd. It's the rematch. Mankato West and Chanhassen, the winner, will go to the state playoffs. The loser is out.
You know, Coach Helgett really summed that up well in terms of there's a true tragedy that one of these teams is not going to make it to the state.
And this comes up every year
with
the way that things are set up.
This lined up. But this truly could be a state championship game. And in covering this game, I'm kind of going to treat it that way in my mind just to kind of absorb it and enjoy it.
Right.
It's going to be a clash.
Well, and he's not trying to create bulletin board material for all the other teams that will make the state tournament.
No,
I think an argument can be made that Mankato West and Chanhassen have been the two top teams in 5A.
No doubt.
No offense to Andover or Alexandria or Rogers. They've had great seasons too.
Mm-hmm.
But I think when you look at the way that the rankings have come out over 5A over the course of the year, those two teams really stood out.
So. And when I did cover that previous game, it literally was kind of a coin toss. It was just a couple plays away for Mankato West to be right there.
Yeah.
So like Coach said, so I can't wait for the game.
Yeah. Well, Rogers High lost their season finale to Mankato West, but they geared back up. And they're in the Section 6 5A final on Friday night against Monticello. It's another opportunity to watch a very unique athlete in defensive end Wyatt Gilmore, an Oklahoma commit. Here's head coach Mark Franz.
He is a special athlete. I mean, he is getting a ton of attention, and rightfully so. I mean, he's about 6'4", he's 245, and he high jumps in track. I mean, just with that much size and weight, he can do like 6 foot on the high jump, and then he just picks up different things. Plus, I like that he's fearless, because he had played basketball all the way up through youth, and he was a basketball player, and he just kind of figured out, you know what, basketball's not for me. So this past winter, he went out and tried wrestling that he had not done before. And I think for someone like that, I mean, Wyatt's on the football field, he's been looked at as being the best player, one of the best players on the team going through there. And for him to put himself in that position and say, you know what, I'm gonna go out for wrestling. I don't know a whole lot about it. And it's such a technical sport. And he just put himself out there and said, I'm gonna do this. I wanna try it. And doing that, so that's why Fearless came to mind, where he's just excited to try different things.
Coach Franz uses the word fearless with Wyatt Gilmore.
Yeah.
That is very accurate, because as we learned in the food weakness story, Wyatt puts both ketchup and ranch on his pizza. You have to be fearless
to do that. And you have to have an iron gut as well for that. The Class 5A section finals. Here's some games of note that we are covering on Friday night. Monticello Rogers, Mankato West Chan. How about Jefferson, the 2 seed against St. Thomas Academy? Elk River upset Sauk Rapids Rice. They will play at Andover. We'll talk about
that in a minute.
Brainerd-Alexandria is a rematch. Alex beat Brainerd earlier this year. And, of course, the battle between Cooper and Armstrong, just a few of the 5A section final games on Friday night.
Class 5A was
so much
the
fun.
Most thoroughramic class we had, and that would be thoroughly dynamic, thoroughramic class overall. So, yes, all of those matchups
so much fun to
are
cover
appropriately outstanding.
And we've talked about this over and over during the course of this show. The high school league's decision to make some changes in the schedule has produced some outstanding matchups all season long.
It was the best year ever for 5A, for sure.
I agree. That Elk River-Andover game likely will hit the over. It certainly is a trend when you look at the last four meetings between these two teams spanning three seasons.
Are you ready for this? The two teams have scored a combined 391 points in their last four games against each other.
Here's the breakdown. Andover won 63-56 in the regular season this year.
Whoa.
Last year, Elk River beat the Huskies twice, putting up 118 points in two wins. Crazy. In 2021, Andover beat them 49-31. The last four meetings, 391 points. Buckle up in Andover on Friday night. It's going to be a lot of fun.
Oh, and oh, by the way, should we mention that Andover scored 84 points in their last game against Cambridge Isanti.
Yeah.
That kind of, what is the over-under in that game,
You
by
know
the way?
What? That's, I should have said a number. I don't know. Maybe 120 points.
Okay, I'll take the over.
It's going to be fun. On November 3rd, all the classes will be playing mostly on the same night. For 6A, that means the tougher matchups now across the board. And for number one seed Centennial, they will play 5-seed Prior Lake. And I talked to Centennial head coach Mike Diggins about his team and this matchup.
It starts with our quarterback in Dalen Cummings. He's the straw that stirs the drink, I always say. He's very smart, probably the most intelligent football player, football IQ I've ever coached. He can throw, he can run. He puts us in the right sets. He does a lot of the play calling on the line. We feel good about him, and then Maverick Harper is an exceptional running back that runs with speed and power, and you don't find that too often with a combo of that. Marcus Whiting is an exceptional player, and I've always said if he was 6'4", he'd be going to the Gophers. You know, he's that type. He's got a motor. He's a guy that leads us in TFLs. He's a sack machine, always plays hard. And we have another one, Melvin Wallace, too, inside is a very good football player that also plays well on the defensive line.
How concerned are you when you see number 99 on the defensive side of the football over there, the kid that's going to the Gophers?
I'm always concerned, no matter who we play, but 99 is a very good football player. I think number 8 is a really good safety. Might be the best safety we faced all year. He's a very physical running back, and he's a very physical safety, so which could cause us a lot of problems.
When you get to this round of 6A, what does it come down to?
It comes down to not making mistakes. I mean, pretty much all the teams are even right now. It comes down to not making a mistake, playing solid football. Don't do anything don't put anything in that's new and throws you off that week or confuses players.
So just for clarification's sake, number 99 for Prior Lake is Jadae Abasiri, who is going to the Gophers on scholarship, and number 8 is Hunter McGilvray, who plays both safety and running back for Prior Lake.
A couple things that Coach Diggins said that I like. First of all, when you call Dalen Cummings the smartest quarterback he's ever talked about, that makes sense because if you've seen our show before, Dalen invented the fess bump ache, which is that great fake chest bump handshake.
Right.
But more importantly, I love what he says about mistake-free football, about their team, because this time of year, it truly is about being the more mistake-free team because a lot of teams are very close now in terms of quality and in terms of competitiveness. But I've seen Centennial not only this year and previous years, and they do take pride in the discipline they have. They're very physical, one of the most physical 6A teams.
Yeah.
But they take a lot of pride in being disciplined and playing mistake-free football. That could take them a long way.
And what I love about what he said there is that, and some coaches do and some coaches don't, they're not going to put anything new in.
Mm-hmm.
you're going to go with what got you here,
yes.
right? You're not going to play around and try to be cute and add some things at the end. You're just going to go with what got you here. And I think that's a testament to him.
It too, is. Right? And we broke down the kind of their playbook, that spotlight game
yeah.
I covered in Totino Grace. And they really don't have a lot of plays. They basically line up and say, okay, stop us.
Right.
And
that's hard to do. Mm-hmm. I got to show you this from Friday night, Class 6A. Rosemount beat Blaine 51-7, thanks in large part to Mackie Whelan, who scored 3 touchdowns in 25 seconds.
What?
Watch.
What?
Whelan's the receiver, number 21, catches the touchdown pass from Gavin Caswell. That's the first touchdown.
What?
After a botched kickoff where Blaine didn't recover and Rosemount did, the very next play, it's another touchdown pass to Whelan from Caswell. That's 2 touchdowns. Blaine gets the ball back. Their first offensive play, the quarterback is hit and he fumbles.
No.
Who picks it up?
No.
Mackie Whelan and scores a touchdown.
3
touchdowns in 25 seconds.
What?
That is incredible.
You know, that literally, how improbable is that? Like, literally, how...
What are the odds?
You
right?
and I have seen probably hundreds of thousands of plays in our lifetime between high school, college, and NFL games, in football in general. And I just don't even know. I saw it, and I still don't comprehend how it's possible.
Right.
3 touchdowns in 25 seconds.
Well, my thanks to Jeff Erdman, the head coach at Rosemount,
wow.
who sent me that video and said, geez, you got to put this on. This is incredible. And he's right. It was incredible.
That was amazing.
All right, let's check out the 6A matchups of note that we'll be following on Friday night. There's the Prior Lake Centennial. The defending state champion is Maple Grove. They will host Edina. I love some of these matchups. Forest Lake and Lakeville North. Shakopee and Lakeville South. Rosemount, Woodbury, Eastridge, Minnetonka. Eastridge is a 6 seed, Minnetonka a 2 seed. Those are some of the games we're going to keep an eye out for on Friday night in Class 6A.
How about
anything stand out there for you?
Yeah, how about Edina? They started out 1-3, and they've won 5 in a row, and now suddenly a team that nobody wants to play. Probably the most super intriguing game for me is the Lakeville South Shakopee game. I mean, South has played well all year, but you can argue they are peaking at the right time. The last 3 games, they've won by an average score of 52-6.
Yeah.
So
talk about a physical game. That will be a physical game,
yep.
too. All right. Well, every football team starts the season with a motto, a slogan, words to inspire them to greatness. Some teams live up to them, some fall short. But words are important for more than just wins. They are oftentimes words to live by.
Climb the ladder. Ladder's an acronym. Leadership, accountability, discipline, determined, empower, and resiliency. And some of those I think kids do better with, but the accountability one is challenging. Holding others accountable is something that's tough for kids to do.
So our mantra is be an uncommon man, be set apart from the world. In a great way, be a man of integrity. So our values that we preach on are be a man who serves, looks outside of yourself. Well, football's the best game because to be a great team, you need every single kid. And so how can you serve? My service might be being the best scout offensive lineman that I can be to get our defense ready to play on Friday night. Our T is being tough, and not just being tough, fighting through something that's bothering you physically.
I like to talk a lot about being a masculine man. And a masculine man isn't, the bully is not a masculine male. It's, how to treat women, how to treat teachers, how to treat elders, how to treat your adults. Just kind of the old school morals of what, we were taught. And so, I think we need more masculine men and better leaders in this world. So hopefully, we're building those types of kids at Hill Murray.
As far as the leadership, the friendship piece, the what it takes to grind something out, and it might just make you a better young man and or woman. So that's what we try to do.
It's on Friday night when guys want to go make poor decisions, being the guy who says, I'm not getting in the car. I'm not going to that party. Being a man who's accountable is our A. Holding your teammates, holding your classmates accountable to having character and integrity.
But we talk a lot about empower. And when you play football, whether you like it or not, you're on a pedestal. And everybody knows you play football, teachers know you play football, and how you choose to use that, that platform is important. And you can use it for negative, you can use it for positive. But if you choose to use it for positive and make a difference, that's huge.
I love that conversation.
That's beautiful. You know, Rob Reed's just nailed that.
Yeah.
When you're talking about the masculine man, and you think about football being this tough, masculine sport with the stereotypes of toughness and testosterone, right. But speaking about the true masculine man is the guy that knows how to treat women, how to treat everybody with respect and sensitivity. That's just absolutely brilliant, and we need to reinforce that more.
You know, I totally agree, and I think that sometimes football coaches don't get enough credit for the things that they teach beyond the X's and O's, because in all my conversations I've had with football coaches over the years, and 40 years I'm talking about,
right.
This kind of conversation comes up a lot,
and
you see it a lot in how these teams and these coaches build that camaraderie and those players. And the real testament, Craig, is when they come back 10 years later, 20 years later, and they're married and they have kids, and they say to that coach, thank you
for helping me a successful person in that regard. And I just had this conversation with head coach Matt Gegenheimer of Prior Lake before the last game I covered against Moundsview. And he was talking about the word culture and how teams want to create this culture of exactly all these things: accountability, responsibility, character, integrity. And I can tell in the kids when I talk to them before the game, when I interview them after the game, the culture that's created around them, that, you know, they're respectful, they're polite, it's all these things that were talked about in that story right there. They do come out, and it's a credit to the coaches.
I could talk about this
forever.
It's very, very important stuff. All right, Class 4A continues to be a wide open class. I don't think there's any question. Becker is the favorite. They're undefeated going into the section finals. But others like Orono think they've got a shot. How do you see 4A? Is 4A wide open?
You know, I think it is. I think there's a, you know, you look at the top 10 teams even, I think they all compete. And on any given night, any one of them could win. That's the fun part about 4A. I know 5A is the same way, but 4A, you look at the top teams and year in and year out, it's just fun to see them compete. And I think every year you look at it, any team can win. And when you get to playoff football, depending on if you're healthy or not, it just takes one game. And I think we proved that a couple years ago when we made it to the state semis. Our mindset is really just, it's really not who we're playing. We're just playing against ourselves and just showing up on Friday night to play the best game that we can. And, you know, playing against opponents maybe that have been better than us in previous years, our kids have really encompassed saying, we're going to show up. We're just going to play our game and see how it turns out.
Is this the year? Is this the group? Is this the team?
Well, you know, I hope it is. But, you know, at the end of the day, I just have really enjoyed this group. Obviously, being able to coach them since they've been in fourth grade, watching them grow up, it's a special team. I mean, there's no doubt about it. It's special because my son's on it, and it's special because I know these kids so well. But, you know, every year we look at success and what does success really mean. At the end of the day, for us as a program and for this group of kids, they've already been successful. They've already reached the pinnacle. They're great young men, and I've really enjoyed coaching all of them. So,
all right, so let's look at some of the 4A, 3A matchups and section finals on Friday night. Delano is at Orono. Delano upset Mound West Tonka to get to this game. Ricori and Becker being played at Monticello High School is going to be a monster matchup. So much fun. Dasso Cokato against undefeated Litchfield. That game's in Buffalo on Friday night. Holy Family, Minneapolis North. Dan O'Brien.
Here we go.
Remember, we talked to Charles Adams, Craig, in the summertime about the possibility of playing Holy Family
in
a section game. And he was so excited to have to face O'Brien and Dave Nelson and Jeff Ferguson. Yeah, it's going to be awesome. St. Agnes, undefeated on the year. They get Cannon Falls in their section final. That game being played at Watertown Mayor High School, and Marshall and Hutch. Just some of the games we're looking at on Friday night.
You know, then that Orono team really does have a great chance.
Yeah.
I was resounder-est. That's resoundingly impressed. I was resounder-est when I saw them in our spotlight game a few weeks ago. And how about Holy Fam? Look it up right now. I'll keep talking. You look it up. Resounder-est. It's in the R's.
Yes.
How about Holy Family? They just keep going with that great 35-28 win over St. Croix Lutheran.
That's not in
now
here.
Facing a Minneapolis North team that has won by an average score of 37-5.
You're making that stuff
up. Just made it up that you actually looked. You didn't look.
I looked. All right. Not sure if we have another rainy night in our playoff future, but if we do, I doubt we'll see a team celebrate like how Randolph High School did after their first playoff win last week. Check it out. Randolph football players after a rain-soaked section victory on Tuesday night. I'm sorry. This looks fun. Randolph lost to St. Agnes in the section semi on Saturday, but this will be a memory that they will talk about for years to come.
You know, I noticed something. Can we play the beginning of that again?
Sure.
Watch the arrow to this kid and watch how far he travels in the mud. Like, there he goes. He's going, going.
Right,
he's
out
still
of the picture.
He went out of the frame. As far as we know, he's still going today in the mud. If we went back to that field, he might still be traveling. Like, that's got to be like 20 yards.
I think we could just roll this video for the rest of the show and we'd all be
fine.
Oh, that's great. All right, we both think the coaching in this state is fantastic for football. Not just about X's and O's, but how coaches teach life through the game. But coaches themselves face challenges too, some that you might not expect. Yeah.
Go, come on now.
I think honestly the biggest challenge for me is just the amount of players that we have and connecting with them all, and it's an exciting time. I think the best thing that you can do is have more and more people in your program, the more people that are invested and involved, but it just comes down to how much time can you connect personally with every single one of them. I do my best. I know our staff does our best, but that's the one thing that we're really focused on.
What's the biggest challenge for you as a coach?
Decisions, making decisions, making. I'm a processor, and it drives my coordinators nuts because you know, they are people that want answers now. And I'm like, you know, my wife's to the point where she'll tell me something and she'll say, we're going to talk about this in 2 days. Here's what I need you to think about. And so that's a little, you know, sometimes challenging.
My biggest thing is putting the best product I can give you with less. You know, our linemen should be receivers and running backs. But sorry, bro, you got played a lot. So, and that's not really different than small schools all over the place as far as the line, but I would say the biggest thing is just numbers and great kids, but not necessarily football players.
The biggest one we faced is managing expectations and trying to ensure kids know that it is about those life lessons and not solely about some of those things that they see on social media. It's not about followers, it's about when you face tough times, when you face good times, who you are as a person.
It's a big job, and it's, I wouldn't trade it for the world, but it's but it involves a lot more than just X's and O's. It's getting the community excited, having buy-in, keep pushing the envelope so you got excitement stuff for the kids, things like that. That I think it's a lot of these high school coaches, I don't think people realize all the work that they put into it, because it's a lot of work.
It's worth repeating what we just were talking about, but year after year on this show, one of my favorite things personally, and one of the best elements of feedback I get from all you viewers, is all the great content we get from interviewing the amazing high school coaches in this state. Right, right. The transparency, the very raw realism, the emotion. They are dynamically great people leading and developing great people.
And we see that every week. You know, every season, every week. I agree.
We can't get enough of it.
We can't. All right, let's check out Hot Highlights.
Hot Highlights is sponsored by TrueStone Financial.
Three new choices for you this week. Hot Highlight number one, Cal Pilon, the big tipped, then interception, takes it all the way for the touchdown for Armstrong against St. Louis Park. Great play. That's Hot Highlight number one.
Hot Highlight number two is a wingback pass by Ty Jensen of Chanhassen to a wide-open Gunnar Bergstrom. A little razzle-dazzle thunder by the storm. That's Hot Highlight number two.
Watch this run by Tyler Wilkinson of Spring Lake Park. They can't bring him down.
Wow.
It's Hot Highlight number three, a 44-yard touchdown
that
run.
That could be Weeble.
That could be easily a Weeble. All right, the rest is up to you. You have until Friday afternoon at 3 o'clock to go to care11.com and vote for your favorite. I'll announce the winner during the Prep Sports Extra Friday night at 10:15 on Care. All right, now it's time.
Speaking of Weeble.
For Weeble of the Week.
And we're getting down to the end. Only two more Weebles to be announced this year. You know, the anti-collapsers, the ones tacklers fear?
Weebles wobble, but they don't fall down.
Just try to make a defensive stop on this crop, and you might, to your knees, drop. Left on the ground to flop, just because you tried to make a pop.
Hey, look at me and Weeble.
You know, when I play this video 10 times, don't get all up in a tizzy, because I played it 10 times fast and I literally got dizzy. You'll see what I'm talking about with winner quarterback Jacob Sampson of Moundsview Junior, 6'3", 180. This is a game from October 18th against St. Michael Albertville. Let's watch what he does. First, a little juke, another juke there. Spin!
Oh boy.
And then another juke.
Oh.
Now we're gonna analyze this again in slow-mo. So the jukes are great. I love the movement. Whoop. There, the juke. The spin is amazing.
That's, and we're gonna Chuck Foreman.
That. Yeah, that's Foreman. Now watch, he sticks the ball up. He gets skinny, like sucks it in there. Gets skinny so he can't get tackled. But I wanna analyze this spin again, because you know what I figured out?
What's that?
If you do run this play 10 times fast, you actually do get dizzy.
Oh, of course
keep,
you do.
Just keep watching.
Of course you do.
It's like I have watched hundreds of thousands of plays, and I don't know if one has ever made me dizzy. You know what? He's going to be called not only the Weeble winner, but he's now the Dizzerator.
The Dizzerator.
Jacob Sampson can go, man, I can't even see anymore. Thank you for spinning our world.
I don't think
and,
that's
and winning the Weeble of the
easier.
Week. You're looking Dizzerator. Up Dizzerator.
God, you just make up so many words.
Yeah, keep
you should
looking.
Have your own dictionary.
You know what? You said it looked like I was wearing pajamas on this show. I thought the blue looked good with the black background, at least.
I'm blending in.
We can't see you because you have black on. You look like a floating head.
There are many shows I'd love just to blend into the background.
Just fade away and get away from
things that you've said.
Well, at least I can take a nap, apparently, after
apparently
the show.
Apparently you can. Yes. But I'm sure a lot of viewers are already doing that after watching. That's it for the show. We are back next Friday for the section or the state playoffs.
Yep.
Our last prep preview show is next Wednesday. So Craig and I will be together for that one. Yep. It is section final night in high school football on Friday night. Prep Sports Extra at 10:15 on CARE, at 11 o'clock on cable, on YouTube, on care11.com and care11 plus. Should be a lot of fun.
I know.
Should be a lot of fun.
If your parent was a clown, like their profession, like in a circus or something, would they be more approachable or scarier?
Probably scarier.
Yes, that's their answer. See you for the football.
And we leave you with that.